欢迎。
All right. Hey, thanks everyone. We'll conduct the session in English for very obvious reasons, but it's actually one of the best things about, I guess, this panel, because as you can see, this is a very rare mix of amazing people who covers all, you know, all over Asia, right? We've got folks from Japan, we've got folks who know like Southeast Asia, folks who know the US, folks who know emerging market. So we're looking forward to a great discussion here. As you can see, there's like six panelists. We don't have that much time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask each and every one of them very quick, 5 minutes, to just share a little bit about, you know, who they are, what they do, and what some of their observations are for the ecosystem that they're familiar with. So for example, for Thaddeus's case, you know, even though he runs around the region in Asia, or even mid-Asia, I guess, you know, he knows Southeast Asia probably very well. So we'll ask him to start off, and then we'll just kind of go down, you know, the panel. Just very quick, 3 to 5 minutes.
All right. Thanks, Kwan. I think you know Southeast Asia better than me. You run around more than me. So we're going to ask you some questions as well. Hi everyone, my name is Thaddeus. I'm co-founder at E27. We do technology, media, and events. Our core vision is to empower entrepreneurs in Southeast Asia with tools to grow their businesses. So we are more known for the media and the events, and right now we're building up the third part of the business for the platform. We've been doing a lot of events in Southeast Asia. We do small events here in Taiwan, Taipei every year, in somewhere between March and April. So what I personally observe is that there's a lot of growth in terms of the appreciation of technology in Southeast Asia plus East Asia. The talents are starting to emerge. The investments on the early stage to pre-Series A, Series A is starting to happen. I think 2 years ago, maybe the investors here can comment on that. 2 years ago, we were talking about that Series A crunch, which I think we had the same exact discussion in a lot of events. And honestly, I don't see that as critical. There has been quite a fair bit of Series A investments in Southeast Asia and East Asia. I think it's more of the quality of the companies that is missing in terms of the quantity. So for all the entrepreneurs that is here, as long as you build a viable, sustainable, scalable business, you shouldn't be worried about fundraising. Fundraising, talent. And I guess the most important questions that a lot of investors, including Kwan, is when's the exits coming, right? Mm-hmm. When's all the mergers, or you can see some happening on consolidation and all that. So that's kind of make it more a lot more exciting recently.
Right. So thanks, Thaddeus, for bringing up you know, one key point that I personally feel is a critical part for an ecosystem to really flourish. Is if you don't see a lot of exits, it's hard to get investors and the funding to flow into a region and to invest more, because then it'll be extremely difficult to explain to your investment committees why you're putting money in Region A versus Region B when Region A do not have as many exits as Region B. So thanks for, and I'm sure, you know, everyone, again, on the panel, because of the different geographies that they're looking at, for example, Taesung in Japan, the situation is very different, actually, compared to Southeast Asia and or Taiwan. So maybe you can help share a little bit about your observations about the Japanese market.
Okay. Hi, all. My name is Naohiko Hatai. My nickname is Nao. I'm from CyberAgent. We're CyberAgent Ventures is a venture capital that is backed by CyberAgent Group. CyberAgent is a listed company in Japan. And CyberAgent Ventures is we have an offices in 8 countries and 10 cities right now. We have an office in Silicon Valley, in Tokyo, in Korea, and other offices are in 3 places in China, including Taiwan, Vietnam, Indonesia. And our rule of investment is that to know what is happening in each country. So we don't have an office in Singapore or like Hong Kong. That's like a very like a financial office. But We try to understand what is really happening in each market. So that's a strategy. And what is happening in Japan is that recently, Japan's exit was 80% IPO and 20% M&As, and M&As were not happening. So we didn't have much exits from M&As. But recently, the rule is being changing. The big companies are trying to acquire lots of good startups and to try to start new businesses by themselves. So M&As is increasing, and that is what's happening in Japan.
Great, great to hear. Thanks for that sharing. And at the end, after all the panelists have shared their perspectives on each of their regions, we'd like to bring it back and talk about the implications for Taiwan. Every different market has their own unique rules, challenges, and so on and so forth. And I hope the key at the end is we can all learn from the experiences in the different geographies, ecosystems, what are some of the best things that Taiwan can perhaps try to learn from and maybe implement. So maybe we'll continue down, and it's appropriate that I guess the next person on the panel is also a fellow Taiwanese, just like myself. Don't know why both of us are wearing similar uniforms. Pure coincidence, but we'll let Ian share a little bit about his observations about the market here. Thank
sure.
you.
Happy to be here. So I've been with Trinity Investment Corporation for almost 6 years. So Trinity is basically a VC arm of III. III is the organizer of this event. So we are a software focused VC. So we only look at software-driven business located in Taiwan, and by law, we are not allowed to make overseas investment. So for me, it's more like to provide our perspective on what's going on, what's happening in Taiwan. And for Trinity, in our portfolio, about 80% of our company are early stage deals. That is to say, we are more comfortable making investment in Series A or prior, and another 20% are growth stage companies. And so we are quite a small fund in terms of size of fund, but we operate more like an evergreen VC fund. So our investment pacing is quite consistent. We make like two to five investment per year. So what's happening in Taiwan is so we see that it's a growing, vibrant startup scene in Taiwan, and actually we see this vibrant scene is driven by several factors. So we see more and more local entrepreneurs get together to contribute to want to build a better ecosystem. So you see there are entrepreneur meetup almost every day. There are experience sharing events almost every day. And also I think everyone knows last year we have MOSA. So MOSA is the grassroots tech event solely organized by volunteers, which is really good. And also we see there's some government support initiative Idea Show or TSS. They both are doing an awesome job to help to build a better community. So they help to provide mentorship to help to connect the global resources. And also, we also see the investment in the early stage SAR is on the rise. In the past 2 years, I think AppWorks, Chirubic, and also KK Fund, I think that KK Fund just announced they invested in a Chinese star, right? A couple months ago. It's a really early stage company. And also we see, I think just what's happening in Japan, then there are more and more corporate VC, jump on the bandwagon. So Media Tech, Foxconn, Event Tech, the media company, the UDN Group, they start to make early stage investment. Which I think that I see the star is really hot right now, even a little bit trendy, but I think it's a good thing. And that's what we are observing. And the thing is, again, so we want to see more big exit here in Taiwan, so that will bring more investors to gain their confidence level to put more money in Taiwanese startup.
Thanks. Yeah, definitely, you know, getting more exits in Taiwan, I think it's top of a lot of people's minds. And I guess thanks to Tai-san and, of course, Alice from CAV, thanks for the exits that we've seen here in Taiwan so far, and we hope to see more. So thanks again, Ian, for sharing. Next up, we have Katarina. Thanks also, obviously, for SeedStar's support of Taiwanese entrepreneurs. I've been in actually at a couple of the events when I think TK was still running the show there. Taiwanese companies did very well. I think that was, in the beginning, that was one of the very few English-only events in Taiwan. So thanks again, and we'll have Katarina help share some of her perspectives.
TK is still running the show, though.
Great.
Also this year. So my name is Katarina. I'm the Asia Regional Manager for SeedStars World. And as you can see, I'm the only non-Asian person here. SeedStars World is a Swiss initiative. So that's where I come from. And our main objective really is to identify, connect, and invest into the best tech startups from emerging markets. So even though we are based in Europe, we are present in 65 countries around the world, and we are really looking for the next big success stories coming from Latin America, Africa, Middle East, or Asia. The reason why we started SeedStars 3 years ago was that we really believe that while talent is generally evenly distributed everywhere around the world, the opportunities for entrepreneurs from countries like Mozambique or Peru is not there, and that's why we made it our mission to really help connect those aspiring entrepreneurs with investors either from Europe or the United States. While initially we really thought that funding is the main problem in most of these countries, we try to provide additional funding to those entrepreneurs, for the past 3 years we have really seen a shift in what entrepreneurs need, and especially in Asia, I think just this panel proves it, that raising money is not really such an easy issue as we have thought. So for now, we are really focusing on trying to provide more education because we see that that's something that is still lacking. Despite all the financial resources that startups have, there's still this lack of mindset about how to be an entrepreneur and not being afraid to actually step out of the comfort zone and try launch something of their own. So we have been in Asia, we are managing 17 countries altogether. So it's quite hard to say what kind of trends are appearing because you have countries like Singapore and Korea, and on the other side you have countries like Myanmar or Vietnam, which are on a completely different level. So I really think the trends depend on the kind of development of the country and where they're at. So if we talk about Taiwan or Singapore and South Korea, those are, for us, not emerging markets anymore. Those are already countries that are experiencing such a growth and the ecosystem is just so well developed that the problems they are facing are somewhere completely else than the traditional emerging markets. So from our side, there would be Indonesia, Malaysia, Vietnam, India to a certain extent. And then the third category that we see are the frontier markets, which is Pakistan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Sri Lanka. So those are the countries where the startup ecosystem is still at the very, very beginning, and there's just so many things that are lacking. So for us, it's really interesting to observe what's needed there and how we can support the entrepreneurs from those countries to really achieve and become the middle-income countries. I think in terms of support and what really keeps on permeating wherever we go is just really the culture when people are more risk-averse than we traditionally see in Europe from our experience. And then it comes back to the culture that is very prevalent in Asia where people focus more on the family values and are afraid to go out on their own and really be seen as the individual and the main driving force of change. So that's something that we see a lot of support coming. So you have co-working spaces where and different training programs that are trying to improve this kind of mindset, but it's still going to take some time to develop further.
Great, thanks for sharing. And then indeed, I guess your coverage spans from frontier markets to very mature markets, but we hope you'll be able to share a little bit more about your insights on you know, what are some of the common themes and threads that make ecosystems grow. So thanks for that. Next up, we have Wayne, who actually has a pretty unique also perspective, because you do get your line of sight into the U.S., given that you know, you guys have pretty big operations over there. So perhaps if you can help share with us some of what you see over there, and perhaps also share with us how, for example, your center in Singapore works with the center in the U.S. and how the different PMP centers kind of share best practice and I guess any advice for the ecosystem here, that would be great. Thanks.
All right, thanks. Hi guys, my name is Wayne. I'm actually based in Singapore. I'm part of this large incubator called Plug and Play Tech Center. Plug and Play Tech Center is one of the most active accelerators based in Silicon Valley. We invest. We run our own programs. We help startups connect with VCs, and we do a lot of the other things, including events over there in the Silicon Valley. So Plug and Play actually chanced upon tech investments quite a while back with companies like PayPal. One of our hottest companies that are around is called is Dropbox at this point. So you see that we run events on our own, we run our programs, we also invest in startups that come out of other programs. So we're one of the friendliest investors and incubators around the world. Okay, so Plug and Play started in Singapore about 6 years ago. We started in Singapore trying to co-invest with the Singapore government into seed stage companies, investing up to $500,000 into the tech startups in Singapore. At a point in time, we were trying to find companies which have deep technology, patents, and things like that, that we can actually bring over to the US for expansion and acceleration. However, things didn't actually go the way we wanted to. Since then, we've only done maybe one investment per year in Singapore, right? So last year, we actually did a refocus of our plans, not just in Singapore, but around the world. So right now, we're actually working with a lot of corporations that basically need help in terms of innovation and research programs, sourcing for technology, sourcing for companies to invest in, and basically working with them to identify which are the key areas that they actually should focus on to diversify from traditional business units. So last year, we partnered with Singapore Press Holdings, which is the largest newspaper publisher in Singapore, to find and accelerate media-related companies or startups in Singapore. So we have done two batches now of 16 companies. More than half of them have actually gotten follow-on investments. One of them actually have already gone through two rounds of investments since last year. Okay, so this is basically similar to our mandate everywhere else around the world. So we're not just in the US, we're not just in Singapore, we are also in China, in places like Germany, in Brazil, in Russia, in different kinds of capacity. Mostly we have to work with the local corporations. We have like five incubators in five cities in China, which is basically managed by a separate team. So I don't have a lot of insights in that area because I just look at Southeast Asia alone. China is basically a partner with some of the local corporations. We just recently announced a partnership with Mercedes-Benz in Germany. It's called Startup Autobahn. Basically, this is kind of like an extension of our interest into the vertical of automotive as well as IoT. Previously, we did a partnership with Volkswagen in the US, and now we basically launched one in Germany. So these are the typical kind of corporate companies that are basically looking for technical expertise, looking for get involved with startups, and that's why we're there to help them. It started all the way back with, let's say, the telcos, who actually realized that traditional revenue from subscriptions are dropping. Nobody's willing to pay a lot for the minutes or the number of texts, and then they're looking at what else they can do with the 4G data and things like that. And it moved on into media companies. We've done that in Singapore. We've done that with the largest German newspaper publisher. We've done that with the largest media company in Brazil as well. And then now we're looking at fintech as well. So a lot of our activities and investment decisions are also driven by corporations. Because just now when we talked about M&As and exits, a lot of our exits are done through M&A instead of IPOs. Okay, so a lot of the appetite for purchase, for acquisition, usually comes from corporations. So if we can get them involved and get them to understand the startup ecosystem better, then it basically drives more energy and more activity within the startup ecosystem itself, and you see more exits coming on naturally within the whole cycle. Yep. So basically, that's a brief idea of what Plug and Play does.
Great. Thanks, Wayne, for sharing. And this is totally, again, coincidence. I don't know what's going on, but you talked about corporations buying. So last but not least, that tall gentleman at the end, you know, the company used to be a startup, but is now part of a large corporate. So maybe we can ask him about, you know, what startups he may want to buy in Taiwan. But before that, we'll let Lucas share a little bit about, you know, what they do and some of his observations, because they're also a very very active participant in the ecosystem, you know, facilitating startups, communicating with the, you know, pitching to investors, and so on and so forth. So we'll let Lucas share a little bit.
Hi, everyone. I'm Lucas from Singapore. I run the IBM Global Entrepreneurship Program, based out of focusing on Southeast Asia and some parts of Asia Pacific. So SoftLayers was acquired by IBM 2 years ago for $2 billion. And since then, we have been focusing on working with founders, investors, accelerators, and governments across the region, helping startups to succeed, or getting them to expand to other markets instead of just focusing on our home markets. So for example, we have been working with Plug and Play, SPH Plug and Play in Singapore. We've been working with investors like Green Ventures, KK Fund, Cyber Agent Ventures in the various countries. So our main aim is to help entrepreneurs to get to the next round with a minimal cost. So we give them a free 1 year credits on our cloud service and solutions around the world. And in the end, hopefully these guys will be able to succeed and go on to raise follow-on funding and expand to different markets around the world. So I'll share more about my insights in Indonesia. So Indonesia is one of the most exciting markets in Southeast Asia right now. And we've been focusing on Indonesia since a year ago. And we were astounded by the growth over there and the quality of entrepreneurs and the startup we've seen over there. So some of the startups, I would like to mention is like Gojek. Gojek, recently was reported to be raising $400 million at a $1.2 billion evaluation, effectively making them a unicorn on a major US press recently. So Gojek started as a motorcycle ride hailing platform. It's a very simple idea, because in Indonesia the traffic is congested, and cars, if you are using cars to transport yourself, you'll get gridlock. So motorcycles become a very effective way in Indonesia for commuters to effectively travel around the city area. So they started as a ride-hailing platform, as I mentioned, and now they have expanded into different services. Think of it as an on-demand concierge. So you can actually order food, you can order cleaning services, you can transport goods, you can even transport documents across Jakarta. And they have been doing very well. So they charge a commission per transaction of the service occurring on their platform. And they have been competing against the big guys like Grab, which is Grab Taxi, which is invested by Didi Kwaidi. And they have been also competing with guys like Uber, who are also in Jakarta. But they have done well themselves, and it's a very solid success story, by a real Indonesian founder operating inside the Indonesian market. So another one I would like to share is a company called Kudo. Kudo is a very interesting company because in Indonesia there are lots of different e-commerce companies, focusing on different verticals. So one of the largest ones is Lazada, which was recently bought by Alibaba for $1+ billion. It's one of the biggest exits in Southeast Asia for some time already. And so there are more than pretty much like 50+ different e-commerce guys competing against Lazada. So for them to differentiate themselves, they have to reach out to the smaller cities, the faraway city. So Indonesia is comprised of over 10,000 islands. So it's different. It's not just in city area like Jakarta. So they have to get customers from like Jogja, Bandung, all these cities. So Kudo, you know, offers a channel for them by doing offline or O2O transactions through their agents in the different villages. So they call it war rooms. So these agents will be inside these war rooms and they'll be holding a Kudo tablet. And through the Kudo tablet, you can transact on this major e-commerce sites. You can actually order a prepaid card for top-ups, or you can order toiletries, you can order TVs through this tablet itself, programmed by Kudo. And after that, for example, a merchant like Lazada will deliver to the agent. And from there on, the agent will then deliver on to the villager in the war room. So Kudo enables all these transactions to take place without costly advertising costs. Because think of it, all these villagers, they are not some of them are not that internet savvy, and some of them cannot really afford a mobile phone or steady mobile connection yet. So Kudo, enables all these e-commerce merchants to reach out to a bigger, larger group of target audience across Indonesia. And we have seen some other startups like focusing away from e-commerce as well. There's one called Talenta, which is similar to a model of Zenefits, which is something they are eventually going towards. So it's a HR software as a service platform, focusing on helping SMEs and enterprise in Indonesia to onboard their salary, payroll, attendance onto a cloud platform instead of using the manual bookkeeping way that most Indonesian small businesses are doing right now. And we have seen a pretty diverse of ideas, not just e-commerce. There are also guys focusing on fintech, but it's really early right now. And it's very interesting because in Indonesia, there's still government support is very little, but it has been built into a very self-sustaining ecosystem with investors like CyberAgent, East Ventures, KK Fundry, helping to support entrepreneurs since 2 to 3 years ago.
Great, thanks for that sharing of Southeast Asia. Not by design, but we do have a lot of people here from Southeast Asia, and it so happens that in Taiwan, a hot topic is the new Go South policy, 新南向政策, right? So we have these guys who live in Southeast Asia, so maybe what we can do now is ask these guys, what are your thoughts? And of course, we'll get the resident Taiwan investor to share your thoughts as well. What are your thoughts on this policy? What are some of the things that, for those of you that live in Southeast Asia, see our potential for Taiwanese companies to enter into Southeast Asia? And I guess for Ian's perspective is, what are some of the key success factors that you think Taiwanese startups need to have before they can even consider going to Southeast Asia? And before they start answering, I have to disclose for Ian, he actually has a cold. So, it's not because he's not speaking up for the Taiwanese, but it's because he has a cold and, he's struggling to get through it. So thanks so much for being here again. But I want to open it up again for the three of you who live in Southeast Asia, maybe to comment what are some of the opportunities you see for Taiwanese startups.
I think one of the best examples would be iChef. I think the previous speaker was mentioning iChef. So iChef just opened up an office earlier this year in Singapore to explore their Southeast Asia business. So I believe they raised a Series A as well, straight after quite a few years already. So definitely have some funds. I think events like this will help connect you to investors. But coming to Southeast Asia, it's tough because every market is very different. Lucas shared a lot about Indonesia. Indonesia is crazy big, yes, but very, very difficult to do business there if coming from perspective of a Taiwanese. Majority of the markets there are more well-versed in local languages, local business culture. So what I really am impressed is CyberAgent's method of launching their different country incubators is all hiring local managers, very, very smart. So I think that's the way to do it, is if any of the companies here, we want to explore Southeast Asia, you really have to go there and spend some time, at least 2 weeks to a month,
understand the market. Don't just see what's written, see what's written reports, what you read on media and news. Trust me, I'm from media. You cannot really just read and go. You have to go down to the market, really talk to people, talk to your customers, then you see whether it's a viable market for you. Hiring is the biggest challenge in Southeast Asia if you want to explore the markets. I'm selfish, I'm Singaporean. So I think Singaporeans we have done a lot of traveling. We understand the Thais, the Vietnamese to a fair bit, the Filipinos, the Indonesians. We adapt to situations. So I think one good way of starting is start small in Singapore, hire a Singaporean that is well-traveled, like Kwan, Japanese, Taiwanese, Singapore. Right. Someone like this, right? You need someone that knows people. And Singaporeans are very good at that. So that's one way of doing it. Start incorporating in Singapore, leverage on the grants that we have from the Singapore government, build the networks from there. There's a lot of investors for your follow-on funding as well. And then don't look at Singapore as a market. No. Go to explore Vietnam, Thailand, Indonesia, Philippines. That will be my advice.
Great. Thanks, Thaddeus. Anything to add to that?
My advice would be, if you're a consumer player, you're probably doing live streaming, or you're a big EC company in Taiwan, you shouldn't come to Southeast Asia, because I think those who will succeed are companies who are dealing with enterprise. So similarly, iChef is a sort of a B2B company, right? So they are working with restaurants, helping them to make a better service in their customer experience in the restaurant itself. And I also spoke to Katie, Kate from Skyrack. So that solution will probably resonate with the audience and with the merchants in Singapore, because we do have a demand for technologies like hers. So I think in B2B, in Singapore, you'll be able to charge a large premium price, probably even 3 to 5 times of what you're charging in Taiwan right now, because there are lots of MNCs, there's a lot of government-related entities who are willing to, invest in technologies that they're able to, help them to compete better in the long run. And from then, from Singapore, you can look at other markets, but that's going to take time. But I think Singapore should be the first initial market as a springboard, like what Thaddeus has mentioned. And I think the secondary market, B2B, maybe Thailand or Indonesia, but language is going to be a tremendous barrier. And I think founders themselves should not really rely on external hire, should also accompany the external hire and be at the city for at least, 2 months to know more about the culture and the different intricacies of doing business in the city and the country itself.
Great, thanks. Wing, anything to add, perhaps from your unique perspective of having that, again, U.S. Insight.
We have always been accelerating companies around the world, mainly from everywhere else to the U.S. So in general, in terms of expansion and acceleration overseas, you have to spend a lot of time to understand the local market. Sometimes you have to spend a lot of cash as well, even with relocating your team over there to understand the local market to begin with. But in a nutshell, in general, what Tedders have said, Southeast Asia is not an easy market or geographical area to target, because behaviors are different, languages are different, there's no homogeneous language. Infrastructure is very different as well. So unless you're basically looking at a specific market in Southeast Asia, for example, if you want to go to Indonesia, then you should do whatever you want. It's the same way as you treat, let's say, a huge market like China. You have different cities, you have different tiers, different spending power, different behaviors, different languages, even within the city itself. So there are a lot of things that you will not expect first, and you will never have assumed a lot of things to happen. So a lot of intricacies, a lot of details that eventually your product has to be tweaked to those local markets. Your back end, your marketing, even your the way you hire, you manage your own team over there could be drastically different, right? So in for example, let's say simple things like giving your employees stock options or equity, the structure, the idea is there, the concept is there, but a lot of, in certain legal boundaries, you have to basically arrange it in a different way to make it happen, right? Some of the locals might not be used to that as well, right? And a lot of these countries, a lot of them they're not say so comfortable with the startup world as well. So basically, they're more used to the traditional working for big companies, have a stable job, etc. So hiring is also one issue, like as Tedus has mentioned. So I would say in general, go there if you're interested. Go there with an open mind. Be prepared to spend an extended period of time there. Do not judge, you know, before even you're there, you know, be open. There's a lot of things new to you, even things like Islamic banking. There's some like Malaysia and Indonesia that's happening, which is an entirely new industry on its own. So things like that, do spend time on that. But if you're willing to put in the time and effort, take up the risk, it could potentially be rewarding, right? So, I mean, just okay. In a nutshell.
Great, thanks. So, Ian, after hearing, you know, these three gentlemen share about Southeast Asia, what are your thoughts? I mean, you know, Southeast Asia, it's not an easy market. You know, you probably know, out of all of us, you probably know the capabilities of startup teams in Taiwan the best. You know, do you think that it's too much of a pipe dream for Taiwanese team to go over there, or should they go to, let's say, Japan maybe, or... you know, even to the U.S., right? Like TSS is doing, bringing a group of Taiwanese startups to the U.S. Should they focus more on that area, or should they work more with Katarina and explore other markets out there, emerging markets? What are your thoughts?
Okay, so this is just my personal point of view, so not representing Trinity or anyone, okay? So I hope there's no government officials that down there. Okay.
Yeah, and media over there, please keep note of what he just said.
I think that, okay, so Taiwan has a population of like more than 23 million, okay? So this is a market that is big enough for a startup of certain industry to survive, but it's not sufficient to enjoy the economy of scale. But this is kind of the two-edged sword. So there are so many tiny stars, they don't consider their global strategy from day one. That is one thing. And in terms of where to go, I think that US, China, or Southeast Asia, Japan is equally hard. There's no way it's easier to go there. Okay, so I want to quote that Peter, the founder of Pink Koi, he said in yesterday's panel that you have to be there and you have to do some non-scaling things first, and then you try to scale it up. That is very important. And my view is that I do think that the government is not supposed to handpick the winner and losers. So the thing is, if they lose the legal restriction to create a more open, fair environment to compete, that would be the best way to help the tiny startup.
Okay, great. No, thanks for sharing that, that Ian. You know, definitely, I think a lot could be done to improve the ecosystem here. And I guess on that note, I would love to hear the other two panelists, maybe from Hatai-san first, if that's okay, in terms of, because there's also Taiwanese startups that go over to Japan and actually perform very well. I mean, including Skyrec, including VM5, that won several awards at you know, B-Dash and Slush and so on and so forth. So what happens to these Taiwanese teams after they win awards? You know, how can they really, you know, penetrate the Japanese market, or you know, what would your advice be for these Taiwanese team that aspire to be the next Skyrec or the next VM5 and so on?
So I think VM5 and Skyrec won the prize in the event in Japan, but they haven't started a business in Japan yet. So the difficult point is that if you try to start a business, you have to be relied in the market and by the people that who's in the market. So you need to hire a Japanese. And if the Japanese has a good network and can accelerate the business, that would be a very good start that the Taiwanese startups can do. But it's not happening yet. So they've starting to winning. They have our attractions. The big companies and VCs knows about their service, but it's not really entering to do their business in the local market, in Japan. And what I think that Taiwan startups and the ecosystem should do is to learn from, I think, Israel. I've been to Israel recently. It was my first time in Israel. I've been there for a week, and I went to the government, I went to the startup, I went to the universities, and saw the whole ecosystem. The Israel ecosystem is, the population is 8 million, so it's one-third of the Taiwan. It's much more smaller. And everybody says that Israel is too small for them, as a market. It's like Singapore. It's too small for the market for it to exist itself. So they think about getting acquired by high-tech companies first. And they get acquired by Apple, Google, Facebook, Intel, Cisco. And they've started to do this 20 years ago. It was very, very amazing. And when I said to my Japanese colleagues that I'm going to Israel, people said that I was crazy because nobody knew about Israel and there's no flights that I can go directly from Japan to Israel. So I thought that when I was invited to come to this conference, I thought it was one thing that I should tell the Taiwanese on the ecosystem that is very, very different from the image in itself as a country. Have any of you been to Israel, audience? Couple. Any in the panel? Yeah, I think there's few people only know, but it's very, very going well. So I hope you have an opportunity to learn from them. It's very, very good.
Right, right. So thanks for sharing that perspective. And I do remember there, I think there was some media coverage in Taiwan on Israel as an ecosystem, as in recently there was a coverage in Korea as well. So I think in terms of reading from media, I guess that was Thaddeus' point. I think Taiwanese are very exposed in terms of information. But I think the key, as many of you have mentioned, is you really need to, whichever country, right? Whether it's US, Southeast Asia, Israel, Japan, nothing beats being there by yourselves and seeing with your own eyes and talking to the local people, what is the situation over there? Because only then can you form your own opinion. So thanks very much for that perspective. Last but not least, Katerina, would love to hear your thoughts in terms of you've seen some of the Taiwanese startups, they've competed in Europe. There's the idea of Israel and also Southeast Asia has been discussed. Are there other geographies perhaps that Taiwanese companies should consider or learn from or think about? Is there anything missing from this conversation at all about geographies or?
Well, a lot of things have been said already. I think the one thing that we've seen missing or one thing that when we come to Taiwan, we keep on seeing all the time is that the startups just don't think about it. They don't think about going outside to a different market. When we ask them, we always organize kind of pitching training sessions before our events. And we go with them through their pitch decks and see, give them some recommendations, and often the slide of scalability is missing. So it's not initially in their mindset to actually look outside. I don't know if it's because it's fear or because they are so comfortable here, but I think that's one thing that could be improved in general. So the Taiwan ecosystem, from what we have observed for the past 3 years, it's very well developed. The government is supportive startups, there are co-working spaces, corporates are trying to support startups more and more by creating industry-specific incubation programs. The government is trying to promote the startups outside, so there are different Taiwanese delegations in conferences around Southeast Asia, so there's always someone pushing the entrepreneurs outside. The thing that is missing from my side is just really the willingness or the drive of the entrepreneurs to go. I mean, when we talked about Israel, Israeli entrepreneurs are known for their drive. It's crazy. The guys have huge ambitions. They're not afraid. They go, they push, they make it happen no matter what. And I think this kind of fear of Taiwanese entrepreneurs is what's stopping them to grow outside. Language might also be a problem. So when we were trying to, when we were working with the startups on their pitch decks, we often saw that they're not confident enough in expressing their ideas and their business models in English. So always for Taiwan, we implement the small like English class, like business classes, to make sure that they actually have the ability to express what they want to achieve. And since it's a mindset change, it's understandable it's going to take time. And in that case, what's really instrumental is the role of diaspora and all the successful entrepreneurs who actually left the country, and so they either went to Japan or the US. The really important thing is for them to come back and really share their stories that, hey, this is doable, we did it, look at us, this is how we went about it. So someone who is local but who has the experience from working abroad to actually share their knowledge, and even though there might not be a world-known success story, it's still sharing their experience and teaching the new generation about how to go about it where they actually want to start business outside of their own country.
Thanks very much. And I think those are definitely, I think it echoes a lot of the sentiment probably on the panel as well as the audience. You know, for whatever reason, there is this, whether it's lack of confidence, I mean, my take on it is it's not, perhaps there's a little bit on the language, but my personal, you know, observation is that actually the founders here, I mean, they can actually communicate in English. It's not perfect. I'm, you know, I'm not saying you have to be speaking perfect English to be able to communicate, but the message gets across. But for whatever reason, you know, the lack of confidence is lacking. So hopefully, you know, as Katarina mentioned, hopefully we'll see more Taiwanese, you know, who's willing to step out of Taiwan and explore the various markets. Given that we do not have a lot of time left, wanted to see if there's any last advice or suggestions or any observations that you want to share with the audience in terms of what you would like to see in terms of how the Taiwan ecosystem as a whole, whether it's the startups, whether it's education, you know, or incubators, or so on and so forth, what are some of the things you would love to see continue to improve going forward? Any other lasting comments on that would be great. Anyone? It's open.
I personally have been coming to Taiwan for the last couple of years. I think Taiwan sits in a very sweet spot between North Asia, so Japan and Korea, where they are quite rich in their investment funds, and then South, in Southeast Asia, where it's quite a big market to explore. The technology here and the talent here is quite mature. Cost is not very high here. So there's a lot of elements that is kind of right. Maybe the funds are not here yet in terms of the amount or the quantity that we want, but there's always markets up north in Japan that the Taiwanese companies can go up for. And it has shown that everybody's doing that. Going north to get the funds and coming down south for the markets. I think that will be a great way for the Taiwanese startups to kind of build their business across Asia. Yeah.
Anyone else? How much more time do we have, or we're pretty much done? We're pretty much done. Okay, all right, we're getting the signal. No, we're pretty much done. So thanks again so much for all of the panelists in you know, flying over to Taiwan and, you know, sharing their insights and advice. I guess we're all here because we do care about Taiwan. And so please give everyone a big round of applause for, again, sharing with us their insights. Thank you.